Hello everybody, welcome to the EM Code. I'm Dr. Vajiha, emergency physician by occupation. Join my quest in asking right questions from right people to get right answers. The guest for today is Dr. Kasuri Naren, who's in charge of one of the emergency departments in Hyderabad, India. Glad to have you here, Dr. Naren. Welcome to the EM Code.
Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Kasuri Naren Krishnaji, working as an in-charge in one of the hospitals in Hyderabad, India. Thank you, Dr. Vajiha, for providing me this opportunity through the EM Code.
Transferring critical patients after stabilization is one of the adrenaline junk emergency physicians have to do as a duty or adventure, whatever you say. So what has been your most eventful patient transfer?
So regarding patient transfer, I have a very, very memorable experience. So when I am working in Srisalam, actually Srisalam is a place, it's a rural area and a hilly area. Which is far from the city. So it's a hilly area, it's a pilgrims area. So which is worship for Lord Shiva. It is a very small center basically. We just have our initial resuscitation medications and airway techniques and an ACLS ambulance. So we don't have any CTs or we don't have any cath labs, we don't have any surgeons availability. There's only single doctor for that surrounding the 250 kilometers. So anything, any emergency, I used to just resuscitate and I used to transfer to the ACLS ambulance to the cities. So suddenly one day, one evening, maybe at around 8 o'clock in the evening, suddenly I received a call that regarding an assault case. So I went running to my center. So there was a person around 65 years old male patient. So he alleged history of assault with multiple penetrating and punctured wounds on his abdomen, on the back of his shoulder, and he couldn't able to talk. He's in severe pain and he's shouting and the blood all over the shirt and all. So there were many people surrounding him after that assault to my center, maybe at around 50 to 60 members. So the situation was very panicked over there. So he's in hypovolemic shock already. His BP is only 60 systolic with heart rate of 150 and continuous blood spills were there. So immediately I have identified that immediately he needs urgent resuscitation and transfer to the higher center where we can have a CTVS and a general surgeon and an OT. So immediately I have resuscitated my I immediately contacted the ambulance person, the driver. I coordinated him. So I have done some basic required investigations like blood drooping and cross matching. So once I identified his blood drooping and cross matching, meanwhile I have arranged for an ambulance. So ambulance has been arranged within 20 minutes. So after this immediate initial resuscitation, I have explained to the attenders the requirement of transfer. So it's 250 kilometers to the city. So I was very running and I was very excited and very tensed. Whatever I can do, I have to just save this patient. So in that positive way, I have encouraged the attenders and the staff also has supported me. So immediately I transferred the patient into the ambulance with two large bore IV cannulas with continuous IV fluids, with some inotropes with me. So it's a hilly area basically. So we have a lot of curves, downs, and also we are getting out of the hill. So there is a lot of disturbances. So meanwhile of the transfer, I have motion sickness. Two times I had been vomited. So immediately in between the transfer, he got totally, his vitals was deteriorated. So I need to intubate him in the ambulance only. So I have intubated him in the ambulance. So I successfully took to him to the center within 2 hours. And one more good thing I have done is that I have given a prior information from the home, from the my department to the concerned hospital, that I am getting a patient with who requires immediate OT and with a general surgeon and a CTVS because he might having multiple organ penetrating injuries and which he might require urgent laparotomy. So all things has been adjusted meanwhile to transfer by phone calls in between. Everything was very ready and we directly jumped, no CT, we directly jumped to the OT. Found to be multiple liver lacerations, spinal lacerations, stomach has got lacerated, with right sided pneumothorax was there. So after that he has been transferred to the ICU. He was there in ICU stay for about 5 days. And after that he was been shifted to the rooms, and successfully he has come out of the danger. And that was a very beautiful experience which I had during my residency days. And so I'm so happy about this thing to share with you.
Nobody is born leader. You kind of develop those skills step by step. So what were your major challenges in initial phases of leadership, and where do you see yourself now?
Leadership is a quality of an individual that been achieved through lots of experience. So we need to know the difficulties and task of our every staff, paramedic staff, nurses, and our lab technicians. So you need to help them and support them whenever required, like doing the daily work, like helping in ABG sampling and routine blood sampling in obese patients, and simple right tube insertion in RTA patients. I always back up my residents, my staff, and my administration when things doesn't go in our way, and whenever I'm in very unfamiliar circumstances, I try to learn from the situation. And encouragement is also very important in our emergency department. During the course, during my residency, my seniors, my HOD encouraged me a lot. So that boosts my confidence. So I encourage my colleagues, my paramedic staff, my nursing staff, and my colleague doctors. So that creates a lot of difference. My challenges as a leader are speed is very crucial in our department. Speed, spot diagnosis, differential diagnosis, and evaluation. We are here to make a difference in the emergency department. We work in a very high stressful environment. There is a lot of distraction in the ED. So I always try to stay focused during my resuscitation times, during the multiple distraction times. So when any trauma case we receive, and very sudden 2 to 3 crash cases when we receive, like a sudden MI case and a broad dead case, and with RTA with a severe head injury, there's a lot of distraction goes in the emergency department. That's where we have to be very brave and confident, because as in this position, everyone will be waiting for our response and our words and our decision. So you have to be very focused in highly stressful time periods. So that is my one of the big challenges in my emergency department, and I like to handle this kind of difficult situations. That creates a difference between a general physician and an emergency department. I try to maintain that kind of ability. And next, care of my patient is very important. I prefer care of continuous monitoring, regular counseling with the attenders, and handling a difficult attenders is very skillful. And decision making is one of the vital aspects of our emergency department. When to intubate, when not to intubate, when to ask for help, and a healthy relation with our consultant is very important. So these are the main challenges I have in my daily emergency department.
In ED, everybody has seesaw moods. So it is very common for doctors, patients, attendants, everybody to misbehave with you, especially the ER physician. How do you handle difficult people like that? Also, there is a high incidence of violence reported in emergency departments. So how do you handle violence in emergency? Do you have any steps, tactics?
I handled many aggressive patient attenders and consultants in our emergency department on a daily basis. So basically what I do is I allow them to take the charge at the time. So after they completed, I just ask them to sit down in some room, and I just counsel them that what went wrong and what's the root cause for the situation has happened. So after that, I'll ask them to simply write a letter that what can be improved from our end, and so that I can do that from the next time. So when the consultants and the hospital administration has been involved in this kind of situations, this usually happens when there is a overloaded emergency or any delayed transfer to the concerned rooms or ICUs. So when the consultants become a little bit overlooked about the situation, so I try to convince them, I try to talk to them that this is the situation going on in our emergency department due to the overload or understaff, so that so please try to cooperate. So these kind of communication gaps, if we kind to improve that, this could create the difference in not having a big problems in the department. And we will also receive much like attendance in India, like the with the VIP tag, and it's very tricky to talk to them. And special consideration has to be taken during breaking the bad news when there is any death of the patient and sudden death of the patient. So we have to continuously counsel them when we are receiving a critically ill patient. So it takes a really a vital role in the emergency department to how to break a bad news. So I mostly allow all the attenders when I am resuscitating the patient to allow them to see and what's going on. So this can help to break the violence in those kind of situations.
Kids can be nightmare for emergency physicians, at least people who are starting in the beginning. So how was your first pediatric crash case like? What was the best and the worst experience you have with pediatric patients?
Yes, pediatric cases are even a nightmare even now for me, and it's very difficult to handle the pediatric cases. So once one of my experiences was when it is the same experience in Sri Salem, my first case like a pediatric resuscitation in the early morning at around 7 o'clock. My colleague has called me suddenly that there is a pediatric case with unresponsiveness. So I went standing there, and the baby is totally unresponsive. They are trying to just get an IV access for the baby, which they couldn't get it from. So I was just checking the baby, the chest raise, and whether the baby is breathing or not, and the pulse and all. So it doesn't appear like choking for me. I thought of hypoglycemia, so I just checked the blood sugars, and the blood sugars were only just 32, and the baby is unresponsive. So immediately I had a lot of experience when I'm doing my internship in New Delhi. Like we used to keep IV cannulas daily around 20 to 30 pediatric units. So I had that experience, so immediately I could get the access for that baby, given 25% dextrose, and after 1 minute or 2 minutes the baby gained the consciousness, and I have seen the happiness in the mother and his father, which was I cannot forget even now. And that was a really beautiful experience in that early morning which I have received this pediatric case.
Do you have any tips to ensure resident wellness?
So whenever I start my shift, I interact with all my team members in the first 1 hour of my shift. I directly ask simple questions. So, hi, what's going on? What's up tonight? I interact in a funny way. I look into their eyes so that I could identify whether he's interested, whether he's tired, any lack of sleep or any depression. So whenever I identify these residents and if they are going through any kind of problem, I give them regular breaks, and during the break I try to talk with them, like just as simple questions to ask, like to find out the reason. If they open up, then that's fine, and if it's not, at least some way it creates so that in the future they might have talk to us regarding any issues going on. So I ask them simple questions like any issues in the department, or anything pressure you're facing from the department side or from any consultants and all. And work balance is very important, and stress for all the residents, definitely this is a high stressful area, so they will be feeling stressful all the time. So I am here to provide them all the back support to interact with them and to identify the issues. So this way I ensure all my residents are all my residents are very friendly and smooth going in our department. And
what is that one app in your phone that you swear by that makes your work in the emergency easy?
One app in my phone which helps me a lot is the Medscape app. It has a lot of information, the drug doses and all. So it would be very helpful if you have this app in your phone.
Do you think the residency has changed your personality in a good way or not so good way?
Definitely, emergency medicine department has changed my personality in a good way. Now it's been a daily schedule for me to get up early in the morning, go for the duty, and save some life and go back to home and sleep.
Everybody has this one moment that, you know, if you don't intervene at the right moment, the patient's management you think would have turned havoc.
So about the procedure, which if I won't interview, that could create a havoc. So there are many actually. Just recently, 2 days back, I have received a electrical burns case, and he's been transferred from a rural area. So it's been already 12 hours. He has been, the patient has arrived at evening at 7 o'clock. The incident has happened. As the patient arrived, the patient is very clinically sick and the airway is not secured, and he has already developed the context. The burns were more than 60%. So there is no IV access for the patient, and I couldn't check the vitals for the patient also. So immediately I have got his access to his right femoral and immediately decided to intubate the patient. So that was a really very difficult intubation, as I can easily see it, because already the patient has developed the neck contracture, and I thought he'll be having laryngeal edema. So immediately I proceeded with the intubation, and the procedure went very uneventful. There was so after that I have resuscitated him. So this makes a lot of difference, our emergency department. Thank you for giving me this opportunity, Dr. Wajiha.
Thank you so much, Dr. Naveen. Thank you for joining the EM Core. It was a pleasure having you. Lot of knowledge sharing and lot of facts we got to know. We'll bug you again for sure to ask more interesting questions. Thank you so much.